This conference will now be recorded.
Hello. Am I audible to you? Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. So in last class, I have been said about the surgical anatomy of adrenal glands and the congenital adrenal hyperplasia and the primary adrenal insufficiency. So let us continue the topic with secondary adrenal insufficiency and other adrenal disorders. So coming to the secondary adrenal insufficiency. So secondary adrenal insufficiency is a relatively common disorder when compared to the primary one. So it results from the ACTH deficiency often seen in the steroid withdrawals. So that's why whenever you want to start the steroid, you should start with the low dose, lower dose. And again, you have to go on increasing the dose, and again you have to taper the dose. So without tapering, we should not abruptly stop the steroids. So patients seem receiving the high doses of glucocorticoids for more than 5 days, depending upon the dose also it affects. So more than 20 mg prednisolone daily, or low doses of more than 3 weeks are at risk of hypothalamic pituitary adrenal suppression. So HPA axis suppression will lead to the decreased immune response of the body to the foreign bodies or infections and reduced inflammatory response. So what are the other common causes? So other common causes are the panhypopituitarism, which is caused commonly by the tumors or the infiltrative replacement of the pituitary gland. Second one is the granulomatous diseases, and pituitary hemorrhage or infarction, one of the most common syndromes seen in postpartum hemorrhage is the Sheehan syndrome, where we'll have the pituitary hemorrhage or the infarction. So that condition also leads to the secondary adrenal insufficiency. So another entity is the adrenal insufficiency in the critically ill patients. So patients with sepsis or systemic inflammatory response syndrome may be affected by the acute reversible dysfunction of the HPA axis. So the incidence of the disorder is approximately more in the critically ill patient, that is the 30% in approximately critically ill patients. So what is the mechanism involved in the reversible HPA axis dysfunction? That is, first one is the adrenal ACTH resistance and decreased responsiveness of the target tissues to the glucocorticoids. So what are the clinical features? So characteristic clinical features are the easy fatigability and weakness and hypopigmentation of the skin and the oral mucosa. So the side figure is showing the pigmentation of the palmar aspect of the hands. So anorexia, nausea or vomiting, weight loss, hypotension, most common is the hypotension and the electrolyte disturbances, most commonly hyponatremia and hyperkalemia. So that's why patients present with the fatigability and the weakness. So how will you diagnose the condition? So if you are suspecting an adrenal insufficiency in a patient, then first thing you have to do is the early morning serum or the salivary cortisol sampling. So what is the normal value of cortisol? Can anyone say? Can anyone know what is the normal cortisol level? Hello? Hello? So usually it depends upon the time. So it exhibits a diurnal or the circadian rhythm. So it is on early mornings, that is 6 to 8 a.m. it will be more, and it will be lower still midnight. So what is the normal cortisol level during 6 to 8 a.m. That is the 10 to 20 micrograms per deciliter. So if you do the sampling at 8 a.m., if the serum cortisol is less than or equal to 15 micrograms per deciliter, or salivary cortisol is less than or equivalent to 5.8 nanograms per ml, then there is a possibility of adrenal insufficiency. Otherwise, adrenal insufficiency is unlikely when the cortisol, salivary, or serum is less than those values. So then you have to move on to the ACTH stimulation test. So what is cosyntropin? Cosyntropin is nothing but the synthetic ACTH. So we should give the 250 micrograms of ACTH. Where you will give, whether intramuscularly or intravenously, you will give the 250 micrograms of the ACTH. So then after giving ACTH, you will start the getting sampling of the cortisol levels. So if the post-cortisol level is less than 80 micrograms per deciliter, then there is a possibility of again adrenal insufficiency. If there is post-cortisol level is more than or equal to 18 micrograms per deciliter, then we can exclude the adrenal insufficiency. So next, again, we'll move on to the again early morning serum ACTH sampling. So by doing the serum ACTH sampling, we can differentiate the primary and the secondary adrenal insufficiency. So whenever we'll do the early morning ACTH blood sampling, then if there is an increased ACTH, then there is a condition of primary adrenal insufficiency. If there is a decreased or normal ACTH level, then we will diagnose it as the secondary adrenal insufficiency. So if in your exams also, if you write the flow chart, then you can save the time also. So what is the treatment? So treatment is aimed to replace the physiological glucocorticoid and the mineral corticoid levels. So glucocorticoid replacement. So how will you replace? So long acting oral prednisolone at a dose of 5 mg per day can be given, and mineral corticoid replacement by fludrocortisone 0.1 mg per day. So increased doses of glucocorticoids are needed during the periods of minor trauma, that is minor and major physiological stress like trauma or infections or any surgeries or burns like. So what is the adrenal crisis? So adrenal crisis is a life-threatening condition that typically occurs in individuals with already will have a marginal adrenocortical function who are subjected to a significant acute physiological stress such as infection or trauma or surgery. So how will the patient be present? So patient will present with severe shock, abdominal pain, fever, nausea, vomiting, and main thing is the electrolyte disturbances. So what is the pathology involved in the adrenal crisis? So mineralocorticoid deficiency resulting in an inability to maintain the sodium and the intravascular volume. So we'll have the diminished cardiovascular response to the catecholamines, which is caused by the glucocorticoid deficiency. So how will you treat the adrenal crisis? So large volume IV fluid resuscitation, that is more than 2 liters of isotonic saline. What is isotonic saline? The asthmatic will be the 0.45%. So glucocorticoid administration in the form of hydrocortisone, that is 100 mg IV every 6 to 8 hours, or dexamethasone, that is 4 mg IV every, this is a long acting dexamethasone, 4 mg IV every 24 hours, that is once in a day. So coming to the other adrenal disorders, primary hyperaldosteronism, that is also called as Pons syndrome. So it was first described by the Jerome Pons in 1954, hence it is called as Pons syndrome. So primary hyperaldosteronism is mainly due to the release of excess aldosterone from one or both the adrenal glands. So primary hyperaldosteronism is classically present with the two, that is a persistent and resistant hypertension and the severe hyperkalemia. So what are the causes of primary hyperaldosteronism? So aldosterone producing the adenomas or bilateral adrenal hyperplasia is also called as idiopathic hyperaldosteronism. And aldosterone producing the adrenocortical carcinomas. Another one rare condition is the familial hyperaldosteronism. So again in that we have the two, that is the type 1 and type 2. What is type 1? Type 1 is the glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism. That is, if you give the, if you supplement the exogenous glucocorticoids, then there will be a production of the aldosterone. So that is the glucocorticoid remediable. Type 2 is the non-glucocorticoid remediable aldosterone. So what are the clinical features? So mean age is approximately 50 years. Most patients are asymptomatic, but they will, as I said earlier, no, there will be moderate to severe persistent hypertension, which is refractory to medical therapy, requiring 2 to 4 combinations of antihypertensives. And responsiveness to the most of these patients will respond to the spironolactone. So what is spironolactone? Because already patients present with the severe hypokalemia. So spironolactone will cause the, so will spare the potassium. So it doesn't exacerbate the condition. So most of the patients, they respond to the spironolactone. So again, they will have severe hypokalemia, no? So they will present with this muscle weakness, cramps, paresthesia due to hypokalemia. So these patients are usually associated with the increased risk of thromboembolic events causing the stroke, myocardial infarctions, atrial fibrillations, and left ventricular hypertrophy. So what are the diagnoses? So the goal of diagnostic testing is to especially identify and the localize the aldosteronomas. That is the diagnosis through 3 steps. That is the biochemical diagnosis, imaging techniques, and the localization or the lateralization of the adenomas. So what is biochemical diagnosis? So diagnosis is by determining the ratio of the PAC, that is the plasma aldosterone concentration, to the PRA, that is the plasma renin activity, which is expressed in nanograms per deciliter to nanograms per milliliter per hour. So what this ratio of plasma aldosterone to renin activity indicates? So normal plasma aldosterone level is for 7 to 30 nanograms per deciliter, and plasma renin activity, the normal plasma renin levels is 0.6 to 4.3 nanograms per deciliter. So if you ratio these two parameters, if the ratio is more than 30, it confirms the diagnosis and sensitivity remains the 90%. So inclusion of an absolute aldosterone concentration, that is the more than 15 milligrams per deciliter, increases the specificity of the initial screening. There is more chances of confirming the diagnosis. So the biochemical diagnosis. So confirmation of diagnosis by demonstrating the inappropriately high aldosterone levels. So this should be done by creating a state of hypervolemia, that is a sodium excess, which is achieved by means of giving IV saline loading, that is the 2 to 3 liters of, again, isotonic saline given over the 4 to 6 hours, which is followed by the plasma aldosterone assessment. Or there will be high boron salt loading, that is 200 milliequivalents, which is equal to 5,000 milligrams over 3 days, followed by 24 hours, urine aldosterone excretion should be assessed. So what is the imaging? So most of the aldosteronoma are the smaller than the 15 mm in maximum dimension, so which makes them difficult to localize by the routine imaging techniques. So, 18 cut, that is 3 mm adrenal computed tomography scanning is the preferred imaging choice. So, scanning to be done in first venous phase and then in the arterial phase. So, what is the venous? So, in every contrast CT, we will have a phases like venous phase and the arterial phase. So, what is the venous phase? So, venous phase, it is nothing but the time taken for the contrast medium to bypass the heart and the vessels and reaches the portal circulation. That is the portal venous phase. And then we'll do the arterial phase. So, what is the arterial phase? The arterial phase is nothing but the full enhancement of the hepatic arteries. Here, the arterial phase is the hepatic artery phase. So, first we will do in the venous sampling, the venous phase, and then we'll move to the arterial phase. So, these are the diagrams of the CT films, photographs. So, first A CT film is showing the CT taken in the venous phase. So, that is a contrast enhanced CT demonstrating a arrow showing that is a 2 cm left aldosteronism. Whereas the B shows the arterial phase. So, here in venous phase, we are clearly seeing the central one is the inferior aorta. This is the abdominal aorta. This is right side is the inferior vena cava. So, lateral arterial phase, that is the coronal CT demonstrating a 1.7 centimeters left aldosteronoma and a normal right adrenal gland. So, right is the normal, left is the, we'll have seen the aldosteronoma. So, what is selective adrenal vein catheterization? So, what are the indications for adrenal vein sampling? So, whenever we are unable to localize or lateralize the adenomas by the CT scan, then we will do the adrenal vein catheterization. And another indication is that whenever the patient's age is more than 40 years of age. So, what is the method? So, simultaneous measurement of the both cortisol and the aldosterone levels in samples that are collected from the both vena cava, left and right adrenal veins should be done. So, the usefulness of the test is limited by its low success rate because of it is very difficult to cannulate the right adrenal vein. So, here we are showing the diagrams. So, here both left and right side, we will measure the both the cortisol and aldosterone and we will do the ratio of the both parameters. So, cortisol levels of adrenal vein sampling should be 5 times more than the vena cava samplings, which implies the successful investigation. So, lateralization of the gland. How will you identify which gland is involved? So, there will be an unbalanced ratio of the aldosterone to the cortisol in the left and right. Usually, there will be some difference in the ratios of the aldosterone cortisol in the both left and right adrenal veins. So, we will be ratio on one side being fourfold higher than the other to identify the involved gland. So, they should be a 4 times more than the normal. Then there is a diagnosis of that side is involved, and that is on how we will lateralize or localize the adenomas. So, what is the treatment? So, first line therapy for PHA, that is with bilateral gland involvement, is the medical treatment. So, that is first we have to control the blood pressure. So, most of the patients will respond to the spironolactone. So, spironolactone can be started with lower dose, that is the 12.5 to 25 milligrams, and we can increase up to maximum dose of 100 mg per day and supplemental antihep. If so, spironolactone along with some, if at all there is not patient is not responding, then you will have a multi, that is the more 3 to 4 antihypertensives. So another one is the surgery, that is unilateral laparoscopic adrenalectomy. But what are the indications when you go for surgery? So whenever there is a clear evidence of unilateral disease and asymmetrical bilateral disease, and bilateral disease which is not responding to the conservative medical treatment. So how will you whether the patient has successful surgery or not? So there will be reduction in the blood pressure and reduction in the antihypertensive medication requirement and reduction in the plasma aldosterone levels, and there will be a reduction of hypokalemia. So they will, all these parameters will be observed as soon as within 24 hours of successful surgery. And overall cure rate ranges between 75% to 95%. And for those patients whose hypertension is persisting even after surgery for a short period, they will require antihypertensives temporarily till their blood pressure maintains normal. So men older than 45 years, again, any family history of hypertension or long-standing persistent hypertension even after and even after the surgery, and non-response to the spironolactone will have reduced. The long-standing persistent hypertension and non-response to the spironolactone. So all these conditions of patients will have the reduced benefits from surgical treatment, and they continue to require the antihypertensives even after surgical resection of the adenoma. So that should be explained to the patient whenever patients associated with these conditions. So coming to the another important adrenal disorder is the Cushing syndrome. So it was first documented by the Harvey Cushing in 1912. So Cushing syndrome is caused by endogenous hypersecretion of the cortisol. So there are two types of Cushing syndrome, as all you know, ACTH dependent, another one is the ACTH independent. So first coming to the ACTH dependent Cushing syndrome. So what are the causes? So most common cause is the pituitary adenoma. So in mostly 85% of cases. Another one is the ectopic ACTH, for example, small cell carcinoma, lung carcinoma also produces the ectopic ACTH. So these tumors also can lead to Cushing syndrome. Then CRH producing tumors, that is corticotrophic releasing hormone producing tumors. For a best example is the medullary carcinoma of thyroid. So what are the ACTH independent Cushing syndrome? So what is the most common cause is the adenoma, that is the unilateral adrenocortical adenoma, accounting for 15%. Next one is the adrenocortical carcinoma. So next one is the bilateral micro or macronodular hyperplasia of the gland. So here the diagram with all the clinical features of the Cushing syndrome. So from top to bottom, so starts with the top, so it will have the personality disorders or personality changes. Then there will be persistent hyperglycemia. Then there will be transition of the face and the fat round moon face. There will be central nervous system irritability. So there will be fluid retention edema, basically thin extremities with central obesity. So in males, they may develop gynecomastia. All these patients are more prone for infections. Then there will be purple stria and gastrointestinal distress due to more production of the acid. Then there will be a fat deposition on the abdomen and the flanks. And there will be a fat deposition over the nape of the neck. So this is called as buffalo hump. So there is more prone for bruises and PTPA, and most common is the osteoporosis, which are more, they will have the increased risk of pathological fractures. So how will you diagnose and treat the condition? So if you are suspecting a Cushing's syndrome in a patient, then you should advise the 24-hour urine-free cortisol on two occasions. So if you get the normal cortisone levels, then we will exclude the Cushing's syndrome. So if at all it is threefold increase in cortisol levels, then there is a probable possibility of Cushing's syndrome. Then we will move on to the ACTH detail, that is ACTH testing, that is sampling. So again, by doing the ACTH sampling, so we can differentiate the ACTH dependent and the ACTH independent. So first 24 hours urine free cortisol. If at all again it is normal, then we will move on to the late evening salivary cortisol on two occasions. If the late evening salivary cortisol levels are less than 550 nanograms per deciliter, then Cushing's syndrome is unlikely. If at all it is more than 550, then it is possible Cushing's syndrome. So by doing the ACTH sampling, if at all there is undetectable ACTH, then we will diagnose the condition as ACTH independent Cushing's syndrome. So if at all there is a rise in levels of ACTH, then it is ACTH dependent disease. Then we will move on to the other investigation called as pituitary MRI or high dose dexamethasone suppression test. What is high dose dexamethasone suppression test? So what is high dose? So we will give the patient 8 mg of dexamethasone. Then we will be sampling at the 60 and 90 minutes of the dexamethasone dose. So in pituitary MRI, if you see the mass, then you will. So if you see the mass, then we have to go for high dose dexamethasone suppression test. So if it is mass is more than 6 mm, then we can go for transsphenoidal pituitary microsurgery. So in this transsphenoidal pituitary microsurgery is 75% effective. If there is a failure, then we should go on other option is only the bilateral adenoidectomy. So in same second type, if there is no mass on MRI, then there is no need of doing the high dose dexamethasone suppression test. Then you will move on to the bilateral inferior petrosal sinus sampling. So by doing this sampling, if we have a difference is detected, then we will move on to the transsphenoidal pituitary microsurgery. If there is no difference, then we will go for chest or abdominal CT or somatostatin receptor scintigraphy. Then we will go for resection of the gland. That is, so resection, what will be the resection? That is the ACTH dependent. That is, as I said earlier, that is small cell carcinoma of lung or other ectopic ACTH producing tumors. So another one is, if ACTH is detectable, that is ACTH independent, then we will move on to the CT of the adrenals. Then we have to confirm the what is the size of the adenoma and all those things. Then we have to plan for adrenalectomy, that is 90% effective. So coming to the other entities, subclinical Cushing's syndrome. So what is subclinical Cushing's syndrome? That is autonomous glucocorticoid production without specific signs and symptoms of Cushing's syndrome is termed as subclinical Cushing's syndrome. So patients with subclinical Cushing's syndrome lacks the classical stigmata of hypercorticolism, but will have a high prevalence of obesity, diabetes and the hypertension. So all patients with incidentally detected adrenal masses scheduled for surgery must exclude the subclinical Cushing's syndrome because due to avoid the post-operative adrenal crisis. So the best screening test to uncover autonomous cortisol secretion is the short dexamethasone suppression test. So in Cushing syndrome, we will do the long dexamethasone suppression test. Here is the short, that is the change in the dose. There we will use the 8 mg, here we will give the 2 mg of dexamethasone. So a suppressed serum cortisol level of less than 3 micrograms per deciliter after dexamethasone excludes the significant cortisol secretion by the tumor. So a serum cortisol level which is greater than 3 micrograms per deciliter only requires the further investigation. So what is the further investigation to confirm the diagnosis? So high dose dexamethasone, that is 8 mg suppression test, and CERH, that is the cardiotrophic releasing hormone stimulation test, and which one, next one is the analysis of the diurnal rhythm. So because diurnal rhythm, these are the circadian rhythms which are exhibited by depending upon the cortisol levels. So what are the indication of surgeries here? So here also same thing. So by giving the cardiotrophic releasing hormone, so through the intravenous line, so through the IV line, we will give the CRH to the patient. Then after at intervals of 90, 30, 60, 90 minutes, we will sample the cortisol levels. So that's how we will interpret the CRH stimulation test. So what are the indications for surgery? So what is the surgery we'll do is nothing but the adrenalectomy. So what are the indications for surgery? That the first young patient, that is the less than 50 years patient, in patients with suppressed plasma ACTH, and in patients with recent history of weight gain or hypertension or diabetes mellitus and osteopenia. So all these patients will subject for surgery. So what are the conservative treatment is advised in this patient? Another patient, that is the completely asymptomatic those with the normal ACTH levels, and in patients with older than 45 years, we can try with the conservative treatment. What is the perioperative drugs? Because patients with Cushing syndrome are at increased risk of hospital acquired infections and thromboembolic events. So prophylactic anticoagulation should be compulsorily given, and by using the low molecular weight heparin, and the use of prophylactic antibiotics are essential. So Cushing's associated diseases like diabetes, hypertension must be controlled prior to the surgery. So perioperative stress dose triggers, that is hydrocortisone should be started 100 mg IV every 8 hours per 24 hours before the surgery are recommended. And yes, abnormal morning cortisol level on post of day 1 and day 2 is indicative of cure from the disease. So glucocorticoid supplementation should be continued till hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis recovers, that is usually takes around 6 months under supervision of endocrinologist. So what is the results of surgery? So adrenalectomy is effective in more than 90% of cases of the adrenal Cushing syndrome. So resolution of symptoms takes months to year depending upon the patient's response. So failure may result from local and occasionally distant tumor recurrence in cases of malignant Cushing's, that is Cushing syndrome due to tumors. Pituitary microsurgery via the transnasal or transsphenoidal is also successful in 90% of cases. So if the initial surgery fails, then you can go for reoperation or pituitary radiotherapy. Irradiation may require. So bilateral laparoscopic adenolectomy should be considered for patients in whom pituitary surgery has failed. So we should not directly go for adenolectomy. First you have to, if there is any feasibility for pituitary surgery, then you have to go for pituitary surgery, resection of the adenoma. If there is a failure, then we will move on to there, we will go for adenolectomy, that is to bilateral laparoscopic adenolectomy. So other one is the adrenocortical carcinoma. So it is a rare malignancy with an incidence of 1 to 2 cases in 1 million population per year. So it has more female predominance, that is 1.5 is to 1. So age will occur at two peaks, first peak in childhood and second peak in fourth and fifth decades of life. So coming to the clinical presentation. So at the time of presentation, the adrenocortical carcinomas tend to be very large, that is mean tumor size will be 9 to 13 centimeters. They will have usually spread beyond the, they will have the extra adrenal extension. So patients with non-functioning tumors may present with abdominal discomforts and the back pain. So functioning tumors may present as Cushing syndrome. So what is the diagnosis? So CT scan, that is a heterogeneous mass with irregular borders. So the CT film of adrenal cortical left tumor is, the arrow is showing the tumor with central necrosis. So central necrosis is a characteristic feature of metastatic tumor. So metastasis to lymph nodes and the liver. So MRI angiography, which includes the tumor thrombus. So you should, before the treatment, you should exclude the tumor thrombus in the venous field, which shows the bad prognosis. So CT scan of lung, the fifth, to rule out the distant nets, and measurement of DHEAS. What is DHEAS? It is the dehydroepiandrosterone sulfate, and measurement of cortisol and catecholamines to exclude the other important adrenal medullary tumor is the pheochromocyte. So what is the staging of the tumor? So McFarlane classification, so he gave the staging, that is stage one depending upon the size of the tumor and the extra adrenal and the distant metastasis. So stage one is whenever the tumor size is less than 5 centimeters of size. So stage two is more than 5 centimeters, whereas stage three is locally invasive tumor, and stage four is tumors with distant nets. So what is the treatment? So treatment is the complete tumor resection, that is with en bloc resection of adjacent organs under involved regional lymphadenectomy. So patients who undergo incomplete resection of adrenocortical carcinomas, they will have extremely limited life expectancy, that is the median survival is less than 1 year. So even those who undergo successful surgery are prone to develop, especially local recurrence and the metastasis, which typically occurs within the 2 years of surgery. So is there any medical treatment? Yes, there is a mitotane, which is a derivative of the insecticide DDT, that is a direct adrenocortical toxin, so which has been used clinically as a adjuvant to surgery and as a primary therapy in individuals which are with undetectable disease or the metastatic disease, they can go for mitotane. So adjuvant radiotherapy may also reduce the rates of local recurrence. So what is the pure prognostic factors? So depend upon the patient age. So if the age is less than, there is more than sulfur, then it is poor prognosis. And poorly differentiated or high graded tumors and positive. If you after you have resected, after surgery, the resected margins are sent for HPEs. So if they given the positive surgical margin, then they, that is also a poor prognosis. Then the patients with resistant meds. So another condition is adrenogenital syndrome. So there is a sex steroid excess which may present at a late stage, which is associated with an advanced adrenal malignancy. So most of these tumors are the virilizing tumors. So how will you diagnose? So measurements of 24 hours urine testosterone, dihydroepiandrosterone and dihydroepiandrosterone sulfates. So how, what is the treatment? Here also treatment is the laparoscopic adrenalectomy. So open adrenalectomy should be performed when there is a suspicious of malignancy. There is suspicious malignancy. So what is incidentaloma? So by definition, a clinically unapparent mass which is detected incidentally by imaging studies conducted for other reasons not known previously to have been present or not as being present or not present with the symptoms. So what is the incidentaloma incidence? It is 1.4 to 8.7% and which increases with the age. So 75% of these are the non-functioning adenomas, but Cushing's adenoma, pheochromocytoma, and MEDS can form in this as a, incidentally diagnosed. So coming to the diagnosis. So if you are suspecting the adrenal incidentaloma, then you have to do the 24-hour urine metanephrine and catecholamines. That is the first one. So this is to differentiate whether there is a functioning adrenal tumor or not. So another one is the low dose, that is the 1 mm dexamethasone suppression test. Other one is the plasma aldosterone concentration and plasma renin activity if patient presents with the hypertension. So all these tests should be done to diagnose whether there is any functioning adrenal tumor or not. If all these tests remains normal, then there is no functioning adrenal tumor. Then we have to consider the what is the tumor size. So what is the tumor size? So tumor size, if at all there is, how will you consider the tumor size for CT? So we'll go for CT. So CT that is less than 3 centimeters, if the size is less than 3 centimeters, then we should not do anything, just you have to follow the patient with interval CT in every 6 months we have to advise them CT. So that is the follow-up. If the tumor size is more than 5 centimeters, then we will go for adrenalectomy. If the size is between 3 to 5 centimeters, then we have to tell them some important factors. So we have to rule out some specific factors. What are the specific factors? So that is the suspicious imaging features. Then is the age of the patient, that is any patient, or few any surgical risk factors or any interval tumor growth. Then any, what is the patient preference? So all things, that is, if it is 3 to 5 centimeter size, you have to see the other features in the CT adrenal glands, whether there is extension of the extra adrenal, whether there is any meds, what is the, you should consider the age of the patient, whether the patient is young or age, and there any surgical risk factor. So if you rational all these factors, if all these factors are there, then you have to go for adrenalectomy without delay. If no such features are seen or no such risk factors are associated, then you have to again, we have to tell them to come for follow-up for 6 months. Every 6 months, you have to do the CT adrenals. So that is how we'll diagnose and we treat. So another one is with another elective one is a functioning adrenal tumor. If at all there is a functioning adrenal tumor, then directly one move they directly will go for adrenalectomy. So coming the all these are the disorders of the adrenal cortex. So now we'll move on to the disorders of the adrenal medulla. So only one thing important one is the pheochromocytoma. So these are tumors of adrenal medulla and sympathetic ganglion, which are derived from the chromatin cells and which produce the catecholamines. So the first account of pheochromocytoma was published in 1886 by Felix Frankl. So what is the clinical features? So pheochromocytoma is termed as 10% tumor. What is mean by 10% tumor? It is 10% bilateral, 10% malignant, 10% extra-adrenal involvement, and 10% familial. So what is the clinical features? So there is a triad of pheochromocytoma. So what is triad of pheochromocytoma? That is severe hypertension, headache, and profuse sweating. All these three are the triad of pheochromocytoma. So other symptoms will be palpitations, so hyperglycemia, weight loss, nausea, and psychological effects. So now we'll move on to the diagnosis. So how will you diagnose this? By biochemical diagnosis, localization, and management. So if at all you are suspecting a pheochromocytoma, then you have to advise the plasma free metanephrine sampling. So if at all it is positive, then we will advise the 24 hours urine metanephrines and the catecholamines. If these are positive, then we will move on to the CT or MRI. If it is negative or a normal values, then we'll move on to the repeat 24-hour urine metanephrines and the catecholamines. If at all there is a mild to moderate elevation, then we will do the clonidine suppression test. So what is mean by clonidine suppression test? So clonidine is nothing but the alpha adrenergic agonist. So which causes the decrease, which decreases the sympathetic input, that is which decreases the sympathetic input from the central nervous system and will increases the peripheral resistance, renal vascular resistance, will decreases the heart rate and the blood pressure. So that is the action of the clonidine. So clonidine suppression test, what will you do clonidine suppression test? So we will first cannulate the patient, then we will give the clonidine 300 micrograms. So and after at 180 minutes, we will do the sampling of normetanephrine. So normal values of normetanephrine is 18 to 111 nanograms per ml. So if you do the metanephrine estimation, then if at all there is a suppression of normetanephrine, then we will be observed, consider repeat testing if at all any suspicion remains. So by doing clonidine suppression test, if there is a mild to moderate elevation of the normetanephrine or not suppressed, then we will move on to the CT and the MRI. So if age is more than 50 years of age, then we will go for preoperative conditioning and surgery. If age is less than 50 years or any suspicion of multifocality, then again we have to go for MIBG. So what is MIBG? So MIBG is a met iodobenzyl guanidine. So it will have the blocking action of the adrenergic neurotransmitter. So whenever it is adjuvanted or whenever it is combined with a radioactive iodine like a trace cell, then it will have a capacity to pick up the both primary and the mets in the body. So we will do the MIBG scan. So in MIBG scan, you will pick up the not only the primary, we also pick up the mets. So according to that, we will plan for preoperative conditioning of the patient, because preoperative conditioning of the patient in case of pheochromocytoma is very important and crucial, because if you are not controlling the patient preoperatively, then they may land up during surgery in crisis. So ultimately death also can occur. So that is pre-operative conditioning of the patient is very important. So these are the imaging techniques. So in first one, this is a scan where we are seeing the both pheochromocytoma and also the mets. So here MRI, this is the MIBG scanning. This is second one is the MRI, which characteristic appearance of Swiss cheese configuration. So what is the diagnosis? So anatomical localization may be performed with MRI or the CT, but MRI is marginally more sensitive, but CT is better helpful for operative planning. So CT, so MIBG is useful in patients in whom multifocal disease is suspected or extra adrenal extension is suspected. So PET scan using 18F dihydroxyphenylalanine and 18F dopamine are highly sensitive and superior to the MIBG scan. So what is perioperative problems? The adverse perioperative hemodynamic changes most commonly observed with the cytochrome are the due to release of catecholamines during surgery. So anesthetic induction agents and direct manipulation of the tumor. So postoperative hypotension, sudden withdrawal of this stimulus after tumor removal leads to peripheral arterial vasodilatation, which also increases in the venous pooling. So which together may precipitate the cardiovascular collapse. So what is the perioperative care? So alpha adrenal receptor blocker, that is the phenoxybenzamine. So 10 mg twice daily can be given to achieve the normalization of the heart rate and the blood pressure. So it should be given at least 2 weeks to allow for adequate reversal of alpha adrenergic receptors to down regulation. So what are the beta blockers? So after adequate alpha blockade for patients with persistent tachycardia, beta blockers can be given. So, but beta blocker should never be the first option, because the beta blockers causes the peripheral vasodilatation. So, if they are blocker results in unopposed alpha adrenergic action, so which may exacerbate the already existing condition, that is the hypertension. So, what is the treatment? So, laparoscopic resection is the treatment of choice. If tumor size is more than 8 centimeters or any signs of malignancy present, then open approach is advised. So successful operative treatment of pheochromocytoma is dependent on close communication between the surgeon and the anesthetist. So manipulation of the tumor should be minimized and the anesthetist team should be prepared to administer the supplement IV alpha and beta blockers as well as vasopressors whenever necessary to prevent the collapse of the cardiovascular collapse. So another one is the malignant pheochromocytoma, that is a 10% incidence, survival of 5 years ranges to 20 to 40%. So they metastasis to lymph nodes, bone and the liver. So what is the treatment? Is surgical excision is the main treatment, then tumor debulking or in unresectable cases. So symptomatic treatment by alpha blockers, So malignant pleuroma cytoma are minimally responsive to the radiotherapy or chemotherapy. So iodine 131 MIBG radio network therapy has shown to be achieving better responses. Thank you.
This conference will now be recorded.